Yeah, you don't walk into a huge room and go, what would I do in here?
Yeah.
You'd be like, you can almost see like there's the two love chairs, whatever. Yeah. It all makes sense.
We're not going there with the two love chairs.
What's a love chair, Johnny? A love seat?
Yeah, I don't do furniture, man.
All right, guys, welcome back to yet another episode of the Fine Homebuilding Podcast. This will be our last one from Nashville, live from Nashville at the RDJ show. And I'm again sitting here with Mr. Rob Yagid.
Hello again.
And we're also joined by Rich Citro from Schluter Systems. You guys have heard us talk about Schluter on the podcast many times before with their Dietra and their Curdy. And today, I'm guessing, based on what Rich has in his lap, that he is going to talk to us a little bit about what do we call it? Dietra Heat? Is that the formal name?
Dietra Heat is what we decided we want to feature in our little discussion today because it is our most successful product launch. And the industry in the United States and all of North America has become obsessed with heating tiles.
Yeah, for good reason.
It's comfortable.
The cat needs somewhere to sleep.
The pets will love it. And the homeowners, we find, are absolutely in love with it. And it's been going on for about 20 years, but really only in the last, we got into the business. But we've done hydronic heating with a system we have called Bakatech for over 20 years. So we're, in a way, one of the innovators of heating tile. But to use an electric system, the system that we were able to incorporate with our existing technology is really changed the industry and caused a lot of the systems that were out there to become obsolete because of the technology that we employ. The Dietra mat, a product that we've had for over 30 years now, features four major functions. One is a little bit technical technology called uncoupling, which in a nutshell prevents tiles from cracking, which everybody's interested in. That also features waterproofing from positive water penetration, negative moisture migration, and because it uses a cementitious surface, it will prevent point loads from affecting the tile cracking as well.
Yep.
Well, that technology, which was a mat of squares about an eighth of an inch thick.
It's like a waffle grid for anybody who, you've seen it before, I'm sure, everyone.
It's, the people think of it as the orange stuff.
Yep.
And, basically, we were able to modify that by going from indented squares to protruding discs so the electrical wire can snap right in. It could easily be changed. It could be customized. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to install, very fast to install. And you're able to now get the heat benefit as well as the four other functions of the same technology we had before.
Yep.
So it's been exciting for us. It also recently we added another type of mat to the Dietra Heat family called Dietra Heat Duo. The primary benefit of that is if you're putting electric heat mat over concrete, you're going to lose about half of your heat just going to get absorbed into concrete.
Yeah, straight down.
And that's not very efficient. It's not very green.
Yep.
So by putting a special matting underneath it, making the thickness go from a quarter inch to 5/16, now you're only going to lose about 25% of your heat, and about 75% of your heat is going to be more efficient and heat your customers.
So let me understand how that goes, because people who know Dietra understand that it goes down with a thin set, and then you embed the Dietra, the kind of that fleecy backing, right into that layer of thin set, and then you bond your tile to it using another layer of thin set. So where in that system, if I'm using this special thinner 16th inch membrane, is that bonded? Is there an extra layer of thin set between those two?
So these are two examples of it.
Okay.
This is the product that we originally had, a quarter inch thick with the white backing. This one here has...
Oh, so it comes
extra
bonded to it.
Yeah.
Okay, so and for people listening, we're going to have photos and you know shots of all these samples. If you're watching the video feed, you'll be able to see this, but if you're not, you can either go to Schluter's website or you can go to findhomebuilding.com/podcast and we'll have some photos up there for you so you can see what all the products look like. And you can see what Rob looks like. Okay, so we got two different products here. Very cool. You guys are huge into the systems, which I love with Schluter. So how do I buy into this? What does a kit look like? What do I get?
Well, you know, people think of it as being complicated. And the other thing people think is that you have to know a lot about electricity.
Yeah.
Being very honest, I know very little about electricity.
Yeah.
And I've sold thousands of these.
Yeah.
All you basically have to do is get the mat which is about the same square footage of mat that you're going to have in tile. Mm-hmm. That's pretty simple. Of course, you want to decide whether if you're going to put over concrete, you're going to use the thicker version, which is called Dietrich Heat Duo. By the way, it's called Dietrich Heat Duo because it also, when over concrete with a living space beneath it, mm-hmm. will dramatically reduce the sound transmission. Tile's not really good at preventing sound transmission from floor to floor.
At all.
Right.
Yeah.
Basically, you don't add anything to the STC. I don't want to get too technical, but that sound transmission from floor to floor. This adds 20 points to that.
Okay.
Now, just to give you a rough idea, you want to achieve at least a 45 or 50 in any property.
Yeah.
A concrete slab has 28. So by putting this over it, you've already gotten yourself to 48.
Right.
If you didn't do anything, you wouldn't gain any STC, so
yeah.
your 28 would stay at 28. So,
and that's a lot of help for a 16th of an inch, and it feels like thick fleece. I mean, it's not thick at all, really, but it's a substantial looking product. Are you able to tell us what that costs per square foot off the top of your head?
Basically about $2.50 for the regular, and then add about close to another dollar for the duo.
Okay.
Which again, that you'll get back in no time just because the efficiency of the system and losing it
sure.
in heat costs.
Sure. And then the sound transmission upgrade is really just a bonus at that point.
It's a bonus and really only applicable if there's a living space underneath.
Right.
So when you add all those functions of the original technology with the heat and the sound, the deadening of the sound, mm-hmm. you've got a six-function product in certain applications.
Very cool. Okay. And so let's get back to the kit. What do I get when I buy this? What goes into it?
While you can buy these in a couple of kits that we have, personally, I don't encourage it because every system is unique. Every
okay.
room is unique. So you're going to buy the mat about the same square footage as tile. Then you're going to buy the wire. The wire comes in a wide variety of lengths and also in either 120 or 240 volt systems. Generally, the only reason you're going to buy the 240 is if you want a larger system, up to about 275 square feet. The 120 will offer about 135 square feet.
Okay.
So you select the wire, and I'll be frank, one of the biggest issues that happens is people order too much wire.
Okay.
So you want to be careful about that and make sure that you don't plan on putting wire under vanities or toilets. Eliminate that square footage from your plan.
Mm-hmm.
Now you've got your wire, and then you buy a thermostat. So there's really only three things you have to buy. It's actually very simple. Now the other component that I want to just mention is you have to have a heat sensing wire in the system. Basically a sensor that tells the thermostat when to go on and off.
Mm-hmm.
That automatically comes with the system. One comes in the spool of wire, and a second one as a backup comes with the thermostat. We give you two just in case, for example, one was placed in a bad place. It's interesting you mentioned the pets in the house love this. Well,
mm-hmm.
guess what happens sometimes? The pet comes in and decides to sleep on the heat sensor.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, now all of a sudden the customer is saying, well, this was a great system and I loved it. Here's how I know people love heated tile. If something goes wrong, they get very upset.
Yeah.
It's like, take my children, but heat the tiles again.
Yeah.
So that's what has happened a few times. It's kind of funny. And we say, is that chocolate Labrador Retriever sleep in that corner all the time? And
yeah.
they say, yeah. And we say, okay, we just go ahead and switch out the heat sensor for the other backup. And now they're up and running again.
So basically you have two wires coming from the floor. You use one of them into the thermostat. But if you find you have a problem, you can just swap to the other one instead.
Yeah, I
that's
mean,
pretty it, smart.
It, if you,
it's a fail-safe.
It wouldn't be a bad idea to label the other one backup.
Yeah.
And that way you'd know if somebody, 3 years, 20 years down the line, you'd have something to know, an identification of what
smart.
It was.
Smart, smart.
And so that wire just snaps into that grid system?
Yeah, it's really cool and really very simple, actually. And that's why the installers have largely changed to using our system. This gray wire here, I don't know how well you could see it, and probably you'll put it in later. It just snaps right into these discs.
Yep.
It's very easy to put in. And one of the benefits is that since the wire is lower than the discs, there's no chance that when you're troweling in your thin set, you'll damage the wire.
Right.
And that's something that we want to be careful about. We also have instructions on performing testing throughout the installation to make sure nothing got damaged during the process of doing it.
And so this is like, it's a basically a continuity system, right? I mean, does it, or is it actually form a loop, or do I have just one of these 120 wires or 240 wires coming out of the thermostat and it can just terminate, or does it need to be like landscape lighting where it snakes all through the floor and then comes back and connects again?
That's a great question. This technology has a tip, so you do not have to loop it back to the thermostat. So actually within this wire is a very small wire that when it comes to the tip, it will loop back.
Okay.
Now what that also means is you cannot cut the wire.
Right.
You have to order the right wire for the right application.
And so how do I figure out like how far apart are my rows of wire?
The pattern, yeah.
What's the pattern?
Well, we always want a three space, I call it the Goldilocks zone.
Okay.
Two spaces is too hot, four spaces is too cold, three spaces is just right.
Okay.
So you could see this, if you could see it or whatever, that would be the three spaces that you'd want to put in. And the thing that installers really like about it is that if you do put it in and you find you're a little bit short or a little bit long, you'd easily just pull it right out and then just snap it right back in. It really doesn't take long to alter your original idea and change it around.
So what do you do if you have extra cable then? Where do you kind of...
That's a really good question, and that's why we recommend, and you could go on our website or what have you, I always recommend when you're planning the wire for your room, don't plan to bring the wire too close to the walls surrounding the room. People don't walk against the walls. You know, so leave about 6 or 7 inches from the walls, and that way, if you have extra wire, you could put it in that buffer zone.
Right.
We do have some techniques to minimize the spacing, and that would be something you would speak to your rep about or speak to us directly, and we'll show you how you could alter the way you put the spacing in so that you would actually cover less square footage with a longer wire.
Okay.
But if you order too much wire, and we can't overcome that issue, then it's going to be a return situation, and that's what we want to avoid.
Okay, yeah. I gotcha. And obviously, for anybody who's worked with and had callbacks related to in-floor radiant heat, you want to keep that heat cable away from any wax seals in your toilet bowl, you know, under your toilet, because that will lead to some problems with that wax heating up and melting. So is there a recommended setback from a toilet for this?
Yes, we don't want you to go any closer than 8 inches to the wax ring.
Okay.
And there's actually a variety of criteria. Every spool has simple instructions.
Okay.
And, you know, probably one of the most popular reasons why this product has been so successful is our workshops. In the United States and Canada, in North America this year, we'll do 250 workshops, which are two-day workshops, where we invite installers, salespeople, any industry professionals to come in, and we teach them all the steps and everything on how to do these things. So it's once you understand it, it really is pretty simple. But we include in every kit a simple instruction manual. Even if you've been to the workshop, you're going to want to review that, and that's where you'll learn all the distances from heat sources, wax rings, walls, anything that might be an issue. For example, we don't want you to put it underneath a vanity unless the vanity is on pedestals that's ventilated. Mm-hmm. We have to make sure that everybody understands we're generating a lot of heat here, so we don't want to confine that heat. We want it to be properly exposed.
So, very cool.
Yeah.
But one of the other things that we changed recently about this system is a new thermostat that we have. It's a touchscreen thermostat. It's very easy to program, allows you to change the temperature throughout different times of the day, make it go on and off throughout the day. And also, by looking at your utility bill, you could program in your kilowatt hour cost. After you've done that, you could simply look by touching a few buttons and find out how much it costs to run that system in dollars over whatever period of time you choose.
That's pretty slick.
That is cool.
Yeah.
What
it's
we
like,
found.
What's the trade-off for me wanting to be a little bit warmer for a little bit longer?
Right. Well, that's what we got very excited about when we did this. That's when we actually learned that this system is not as expensive to run as even we had thought. So once people learn that, hey, wait a minute, it only costs $3 to run it for the whole week, well, why don't we leave it on longer, or why don't we turn it up a little bit? And that way they have in real dollars an understanding of what they're doing. So once you've bought your mat, your wire, and your thermostat, you've got the whole kit.
Yeah.
But the instructions are pretty simple. You do want a qualified installer to install it, and you do want a qualified electrician to connect it to the power source.
Sure.
So it's
so that just snaps into like a regular wall box. It's like a single
the thermostat.
Yeah. So the thermostat it gets connected by the wire. Basically, the gray wire transitions to a cold lead, and that cold lead simply connects to our thermostat. Oops, there we go. And
the cold lead being essentially that part's not going to heat up the inside of your wall.
Exactly. Right. Whenever you're installing this, we're going to instruct you that the gray wire always be in the heat mat and always be embedded in thinset mortar.
Yep.
We don't want this to overheat without being embedded in that.
Right, without having something to heat up around it, it's going to get real hot.
Yeah.
Because it's designed to be buried.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what people are doing with this now, and we do have instructions for doing this. They're actually putting it in showers, on shower floors,
mm-hmm.
In seats in showers. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some people say, well, that's kind of weird. It's a small shower. Isn't the hot water going to make the tiles warm anyway? And that's true, it will. But by warming those tiles, when you get out of that shower and the base of the shower being wet, that's going to cause that whole environment to dry much more quickly, which is going to make it more sanitary and more maintenance-free.
Mm.
So it's really becoming, and when you incorporate it with a lot of the systems that we have for our entire shower systems, what's popular right now, in fact, what we had Mike Holmes yesterday demonstrating with us, was you're having a barrier-free shower, so there's no curb. You walk into a bathroom with large format tile and maybe wood plank tile, which are crazy popular right
now.
And that will flow right into the shower without any type of a barrier curb. You've got a linear drain so that the tiles are large in the shower and the entire thing is heated.
Yeah.
So this is, and the interesting thing is, most people don't even know these new generation products exist.
Yeah.
So it's our job and our dealers and distributors' jobs to educate the customers. And all of a sudden, it's not unusual when somebody's budgeted $20,000 for a bathroom to say, no, we're going to go for $35,000 because this is going to be an enhancement on our property, an investment that mm-hmm. we're going to have forever, and something that we're going to be able to enjoy, because the bathroom is no longer a place where you go in and do something. The bathroom is a place where people spend more time and think of as their oasis and their way to relax.
Sure.
So.
And so what can you tell us to allay any concerns somebody might have over, you know, I can't get down to this system without removing all my tile and all my thinset. So is there any worry about system breakage or failure or, you know?
There certainly are issues. Now, one of the things that I'm very proud of is we probably are the leaders in the industry in servicing our products. Complaints become our number one priority. So if something goes wrong, and we know how upset people get when the heat goes off. I told you that it's really interesting. We will get there right away. We have very sophisticated equipment to understand what went wrong. We have repair kits available. In the 7,000 or 8,000 of these that I've placed, I've had about 8 or 9 complaints where I had to visit. I've never personally had the requirement of having to remove the tile.
7,000 or 8,000?
Oh yeah. Oh, that's just me. Oh, this.
You
product.
Mean when you play? You say place? You mean you've installed?
No. As a territory manager, okay. I've sold that number.
Gotcha.
So I get an idea of the success rate of the efficiency of it.
And I thought you were a superhero.
No. But it is pretty quick and easy to install. But
yeah.
No, if I did that, I'd be retired on an island somewhere right now.
Well, I mean, you don't need to convince people about how great Dieter is, so this just seems like a natural next step. And what do I need to know about final thickness? Like, let's say I'm butting up to a hardwood floor in the hallway, and, I mean, what kind of thickness... What do I end up at with this?
Well, that's really interesting because typically our system, the regular product without the extra Dietra Heat Duo benefit as far as going over concrete, is 1/4 inch thick.
Okay.
So it's a very low profile compared to other systems out there. You're adding another 1/16 inch for the Dietra Heat Duo when you're going over the concrete.
Mm-hmm.
So you're really not adding much thickness to the overall floor. So that's pretty negligible, I think. The regular Dietra is available in 1/8 inch.
Mm-hmm.
So this is 1/4. And then we have the Dietra XL, which is 5/16, which is equal to the Dietra Heat Duo thickness.
Okay. So we basically have a choice of, when we get into the heated category, we have a choice of 5/16 and a quarter.
That's correct.
All right. And we have an 1/8 inch if we want to go ultra thin and go back to the, just the straight up Ditra.
Yeah, we can't heat the 1/8 inch.
Can't heat that.
But you know, it's interesting because Ditra has this uncoupling benefit.
Yep.
It's very common that people would put other heating systems under Ditra.
Yeah.
What Ditra does, its uncoupling benefit is when things expand and contract, tiles don't like expansion and contraction.
Right.
They're solid products.
Yeah.
So by having this uncoupling technology, frequently people would put regular heat down before our product was released. Now that would it require putting wires down, then pouring self-loving underlayment or gently skim coating thin set over them, and now you have to wait.
Yep.
This system, from the minute you start installing it, you can continue right on to the installation of the tile without having to stop. And a lot of times you might be doing just a small bathroom. So this gives the installer the capability of going there and do the entire project in a few hours. And then you can, in fact, use our fast-setting mortar. We, this year, released a series of thin-set products to accompany all of our products. So now an installer could go to a project, install maybe a 40, 50-foot bathroom with our fast-setting mortar, come back shortly after that and grout it, get paid, go home. Customer has the thing done. But interestingly, particularly since we learned about how efficient it is, people aren't limiting this just to bathrooms anymore. They're using it in kitchens. They're using it in entire living spaces.
Yeah.
It's not unusual anymore for us to go 700 feet. And when you incorporate our 240-volt system with another thing that we have called a power module, we could essentially heat this entire exhibit hall off of one thermostat.
Crazy.
So it's we keep coming up with new ways to expand the capabilities of the product.
Any hints to other products you have working in the Schluter labs that you can tell us are coming soon?
They'd have to kill me if I told you.
That's okay with us.
Yeah, that's fine.
I'm just a pawn on this chess set.
Yeah.
But we are constantly coming out with new products all the time. Some of the things we talked about with Mike Holmes yesterday was our new WS profiles that will be installed integrally into a tile assembly to dam water that might want to trickle out of a shower. Also, our Deco SG is a profile integrally installed in the tile assembly, so a sheet of glass can be installed within that prevents any possibility. For example, I had to go on a complaint where a glass installer went to install glass in a shower, and in that process, his fastener went through the wire of the Ditra heat.
Mm.
So this is a technology that will prevent any following trades from having to penetrate through and potentially hit a wire. It also is a much neater, more professional and cleaner look. So the profile things are something that we're doing, but really,
those edge profiles are really cool. People that don't use those now should definitely take a look at. They really make you look like a neat installer.
Well, of course, the profiles is how this company started in the 60s.
Yeah.
You know, Mr. Schluter in Germany. In Germany, you go to tile school for 7 years, and then you become a tile installer. Here, you go to a big box, buy a trowel, and you're a tile installer.
Yeah.
A little bit different, but he matched his genius with all these products and basically discovered very early on, back in the 60s, that the tile edges were chipping. So we invented these profiles to protect the edge of the tile. And now, I don't know specifically, but we probably own over 80% of the profiles or trim market in North America.
Uh-huh.
Because that was our beginning in the 60s.
Yeah. Well, super cool stuff. And so people can go and they can come to one of your locations and do a training on this if they want to. And that's free, right?
Well, interesting. We do have metal locations, but we have them all over the place.
Right.
I'll be in Pensacola, Florida next week at a workshop. Last week I was in Virginia Beach.
Okay.
We are so high on getting people to be educated, because this tile industry continues to grow exponentially. It has one major barrier, and that is there aren't enough qualified installation people.
Right.
And so we've taken just the point now, we're encouraging people to bring their families to these hotels that are throughout North America. Let your family go to the pool, because some people say, hey, you know, I'm a real family guy. I don't want to leave my family for a couple of nights. We say, well, bring your kids, and they'll be at the pool that day, and they'll be in the training, and then that night, when we have dinner, we'll invite them to also join us. It's wonderful to see families at our dinners. And the dinners at the workshops are a great opportunity for, and this isn't just for installers. I get it's for, we've had facilities directors of major colleges who have to do dormitory showers. We have architects, but it's largely tile industry people. And they get an opportunity to network with one another during our dinners and lunches, et cetera.
Yeah, yeah.
So we have right now over 30 people, close to 35 people dedicated just to our education department.
Wow.
To help expand the knowledge
of
the industry.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those, it's a big commitment.
Those locations are suspicious. Pensacola, Florida, Virginia Beach.
Yeah, a little R&R.
Yeah.
Well, we've got one.
Those?
I think that if by the way, they do fill up fast. So if anybody's listening, you want to register because you might go to
Virginia
register.
Virginia Beach.
Well, we've got one a couple weeks from now at Chateau Elan Winery in Brazelton, Georgia.
Are you going to like Lincoln, Nebraska anytime? Or
no offense, Lincoln.
We really do try
actually
to.
Like Lincoln.
We spread them out. We like to have fun too, but we got to get to the people, and people are all over the place. So it's interesting how you'll do one in a remote place where you won't know that you'll get a good turnout, and the place will fill up early, and then you might have one in Boston, let's say, and you don't have a full house. So it's it's really hard to predict how many people are going
to
show up.
Where do you go to find out information about that, and where to locations and sign up?
Thank you for asking. Really simple. Just go to Schluter.com and you will see a section for education. Immediately, a map of North America will pop up. You can click on different locations, find out right there when they are, what hotels they're at, and register on the spot.
Beautiful.
Again, you might find that it's full, so get in early.
Yeah, that's super cool. I want to go to one of those seminars at some point and just see what it's all about.
Sure.
I think that's really interesting stuff. Listen, super thankful you had some time to come on and talk about the product. Like I said before we started, I've seen the Dieter Heat a bunch of times, but nobody's ever walked me through it. I haven't had a chance to really talk to somebody about the details. So now I feel like I understand how it works. I think it's super cool. I would love to use it sometime. So we appreciate you coming on. Anything else you want to share?
Well, you know, I should have, when you did mention new products, we recently expanded our line of finishes for our grate assemblies.
Mm-hmm.
We went into a chrome finished stainless steel because we recognize the demand to match faucets, et cetera.
Yep.
So this is something, and this is also now available in our linear drains.
Mm-hmm.
And our linear drains go from 20 inches to 6 foot long. And that will also have this newer finish. That's something that we've released, maybe 6 or 8 months ago. So that's
awesome.
A newer thing. So that's probably the most current stuff I could talk about.
Well, we do appreciate you coming on.
Great. It's been a pleasure.
Schluter.com, everybody.
Thank you.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. We've got a few minutes left in this episode. So what we did is brought everybody we could get our arms around and put them around the table here. So in addition to Rob, we got Andy Moore back. I'm here, obviously. We got Johnny Hurrihan. We also have
Jason Black.
Jason
with
Black.
Artisan Signature Homes.
Artisan Signature Homes. What is that your Instagram handle too?
That is all in one.
We snuck Jason in last minute.
Jason, are you in Lexington?
Louisville, Kentucky.
Louisville.
Yeah.
All right.
Yep. All right. So you guys, so Johnny, Andy, and Jason, you guys snuck off today and you went and looked at some houses, right?
Road trip.
I don't understand. What houses did you go to?
They weren't just houses. We started with about a 20,000 square foot monster just outside of Nashville.
But did you like pretend you were shopping for houses, or
no,
what?
So we contacted the guys that were in social media.
Oh, all right.
Some local guys that do development. Some guys we saw last night at the meetup, and just DM'd them and said, "Hey, you guys around?" They weren't even around. This is what's amazing about this community. They weren't around. They just texted me back saying, "Here's the addresses. Here's the key codes. Any questions?" Literally, the one we went to with 20,000 square feet with the basketball court, Infinity Edge Pool, had a gate.
So it was a gated community.
They wouldn't have let us in, and he had called ahead for us.
Nice.
That's wild.
So you've got guys on IG that are just texting saying, "Hey, I build Nashville. Go check out this. We've got some more to check out tonight and tomorrow. Guy sent me 6 more addresses."
What's your guys' goal by going and do this?
Inspiration.
Just to see what everybody else is doing.
So were you inspired?
Yeah. So what did you give us some trends?
It was, I mean, the amount of building going on.
Yeah, there's a huge amount of building in Nashville.
Somebody told us yesterday that it was like Nashville. There was some crazy number of people that move into Nashville
100
every
people
day.
A day.
Yeah,
that's what I was
saying. I wouldn't doubt it.
It was from my Uber driver, though.
Yeah.
Credible source.
Yeah.
Him and Google are great sources.
Yeah, fake news.
Yeah.
We saw, you know,
it's a non-political show, Johnny.
A lot of painted white houses, kind of the, I don't know if you call them modern farmhouse, but steel windows, black windows.
Yeah, I thought brick was king down here. No?
It is a lot of it.
So it's all painted, white painted brick.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Almost pretty much everything.
Not
is
a
brick.
Lot of foundations either.
Better be used in the right paint, right, Justin?
A lot of slabs. Yeah, we just found out talking to Mason.
Well, they don't have the freeze thaw cycles down here. They up north.
It doesn't get cold down. It's easy to build in Nashville.
They get a pretty decent freeze down
I'm
here.
No, I'm just kidding.
Oh. I haven't been around all week, so sorry, guys.
Yeah, so we snuck through what, Chandelier Development's houses, Vintage South Development, and was it Hatcliffe?
Hatcliffe Construction. Southern Living Builder. Yeah.
Was
amazing.
One hell of a
We went through a community. It's called The Grove. It was a gated community. And there
they,
might have
they
been,
always name it after what they tear down to build it, right?
There was probably 50, maybe more, million-dollar plus. They all had to be million-plus homes under construction.
Cool.
It was all really good architecture. You know, a lot of times you see these new developments.
Yeah,
you got some cookie-cutter houses. They were all well done. I mean, we were had the drone out, had the GoPro out, had everything out, taking some good footage.
And this is coming from a guy who comes from a development that is kind of like this...
Trashy?
The poster child for, like... Almost fake, like it's right out of the movies. Like,
yeah, so we
high
build,
end, yeah.
Yeah, we build in a, it's called Norton Commons. It's a traditional neighborhood development done by DPZ in Louisville. And it's a 650-acre plain community that, you know, there's a pattern book that you follow every little detail.
Yeah,
so it really is. It. Yeah.
So I've seen those homes and they're, you know, they're all unique in themselves, right? So, but how would you describe the style that you're going for in that development?
So there's five core, you know, you got classical vernacular, you've got Georgian, you got federal. You've got to really stick to those, you know, homes that were built 90, 100 years ago in Louisville. So that's the pattern. There's a few exceptions you can do, and I try to squeeze a couple of those in. I've done one or two shingle style houses, all cedar shake, stained shingle. So I try to put a little bit of spin on it, but we keep the elevations in the houses very simple and very traditional, very classic is what we try to go for.
Yeah. And Johnny, I think you guys had Jason on your podcast, didn't you? Yeah.
Correct, yeah.
So if people don't know about Johnny and Nick Schiffer and Tyler Grace all have a podcast, Tyler Grace.
Tyler Grace, everybody.
Tyler didn't show up to this show.
He was getting a new tattoo or he probably would have been here.
Yeah, we were waiting for him.
Really, really mostly what Tyler contributes to that show is eating dinner in the background.
And ice cream.
And ice cream, yeah. Right. But no, it's called a Modern Craftsman podcast. It's a really cool show. You get to hear from guys like Jason. They focus pretty much exclusively on how people run their business and how they got into it and how all the trials and tribulations. It's a cool departure. A nice compliment to our show, I would say, Robert.
You could say that.
It is a good.
So I think I heard your episode because some of what you're saying is refreshing my memory.
Yeah, we talked a lot about Norton Commons and kind of the process and what we go through to build in there.
And Johnny's saying that he tried to steal the book. That reminds me. Like, he was one of the guys that originally you were kind of inspired by all of the.
He was one
the
of my
style,
first followers.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you have. I'm jealous of that development because. There's so many developments that we see around here that are done incorrectly. And I mean, you have Pine Hills that's probably similar in size, probably a little smaller, and it's just production homes.
What do you mean by incorrectly?
No, in my point of view, not...
Well, that's maybe not you, but that's what I'm trying to get. Like,
what is that point of view?
Like, what does correct look like?
Well, the size, scale, and everything that's done there...
Proportions, I think,
is huge.
Simple.
And being able to do that and having each one of the houses side by side... have a little bit of character and they play off each other. Not, you know, builder A and then builder C was next door.
Yep.
They basically all play off one another and that builds a community. That's how, like, Hingham. You think that was how they went along and they just was like, they all played off each other. They're all in farmhouse style. They're all white. They're all clapboard. They didn't go off reservation. They all basically played off each other and it was awesome. That doesn't happen all the time.
Yeah, I mean, and the good architects will tell you when we've talked to them about the same kind of thing, and we try to voice this in the magazine and the website is, you know, looking around at your neighborhood and figuring out not just what you want in your house, but what's appropriate for where you live. You got to be picking, and you do great with that, John.
It's even teardowns. Like, we could just go by what our civil guy gives us for elevations. It's like, let me just check real quick what my other three foundation heights are, and mine's sitting up 2 feet. I'd rather figure that out before I pour concrete and go, it is what it is. Yeah. I can tell you there's a million guys that will probably at this show that go, it is what it is.
Yeah.
And we try not to do that. And what Jason's development does is they kind of control that. They curb that. So you're able to sit and do that. And
we have a set of plans that we've got to follow the finished floor elevation or you don't build the next house in there. So it's pretty.
Yeah, but you also have what, deposit on the lot.
Yeah.
And then you don't get that deposit back. If you didn't follow those parameters,
yeah,
that's pretty cool.
Get that money.
Yeah, that's cool.
Well, and one of the cool things about Norton Commons that, you know, you see in there that you don't see, I think a lot of these developments, guys get in there and figure they've got to do more and more. Like, you got to have cedar shake, you got to have brick, you got to have stone, you got to have all these different materials.
Yes, all they want to do everything.
Is all they want to do is pull back more and more if they could.
Yeah, so that's it. It's like, keep one simple material. Maybe you have a brick house with a stone foundation or something like that, but you're not having gables with shake and board and batten and 20 different
the
mixes.
First floor, we talked about it for hours when I went down there, but like, the first floor windows are always bigger in scale than the second floor.
Yeah.
Yeah, you got
now it sounds so simple, but nowadays so many guys are buying the same windows for both floors, and then the proportions are off.
Yeah,
it doesn't look right.
I talk to Rob about this all the time. It's like, you have so many great examples of what to do from decades ago. It's not that hard. Just look around at what looks good and what doesn't.
Well, and when we want to try to get something approved in the development, they're like, go look back in old Louisville, which was built 100 years ago, and take pictures. And if you can find it there, then you can build it here. If not, we don't want it.
Right.
That should be the golden rule
everywhere. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, what do you think? Why don't you go to Beacon Hill? Take a photo of a house there with the detail. If you can find it there, go ahead.
Yeah.
You're grandfathered in.
Yeah.
So I've got a question, because you guys both deal.
End of statement. End of podcast.
You guys both work on pretty large projects. I mean, I know that you were talking yesterday, John, a little bit about the square footage of your houses. And Justin and I have both been fortunate enough to be in a bunch of houses all across this country. And to me, I've been in some mega houses, and sometimes they just don't work for me, you know, because the comfort, you know, the arrangement of the floor plan and the scale of it is just way out of scope for how I could ever intend to live, you know? So how do you guys in your projects, Jason and John, and maybe even in the project that you saw today, are you kind of mindful of that or resolving that? Given, you know, like the average family size and, you know, in a 20,000 square foot house, how do you make that work and feel like home?
We talk a lot about
that
scale.
Thing was huge. Don't use that example.
All right, bad example.
That was a monster.
Maybe 20,000 square feet is a little bit too much.
Although 14 foot high ceilings.
We did say that house did have a cozy feel to it for being 20,000 square feet. Mm-hmm. But typically,
it's all relative, yeah.
Yeah. We go for, you know, ceiling height. Sometimes we'll change the ceiling height up, make a room a little bit more cozy, connect the room to the outside. I'm a huge proponent of natural light in a house, so I always try to get multiple windows in a room if I can on multiple sides of the room. So, you know, nothing is less comfortable than a dark room to me. So I think natural light just breathes, you know, good vibes into a house. So
yeah.
And there was a book that you had me buy, force it upon me. It was, what was it called?
Yeah, Get Your House Right.
Get Your House Right.
Oh, yeah, we talk about that book all the time.
It was phenomenal. And it's little, like, you know how many times I drive by a house and I show it to my kids and it's a brand new spec house, windows in the front, one window on the side.
Oh, yeah, it's brutal.
And it's like, I was taught that you need cross ventilation so you had a window on each corner of the house so you could, what happened to the rules?
Yeah, well, did you know, Johnny, that Marianne Cusato, who wrote that book, she now writes a two-page column in every issue of Fine Homebuilding where she just digs into a certain design detail.
Great.
It's awesome. It's called Design Build.
Yeah, Design Build.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's those simple details, like even shutters on the outside. So many guys will just, you know, we talk about this all the time, just plaster a shutter and screw it straight to the brick or the siding. And
off the trim. Like just straight to the
right.
Siding.
Yep.
Yeah.
When
so
it's supposed to overlap.
You put those, you know, put the hinges on and a little shutter dog, and it changes the look of that elevation.
Yeah, but do you go so far as to actually have those window shutters the right way?
Yes.
I know John does.
That looks so awkward.
Yes. Yeah, it looks
they
long
look upside
and they're
down.
Open.
Yeah, I've had arguments with clients.
Yeah.
Well, we've had to change a couple lately where the shutter dogs need to be on the bottom technically because instead of the side. So if you're actually inside and you open the window, you can actually turn the shutter dog and pull that shutter in.
Oh, yeah.
Here's the thing is it may look wrong, but when that shutter is facing the correct way, it's actually washing the back of the shutter when it's open.
Yeah.
So you don't have the bats living back there, the bee's nest.
Yeah.
Just do it right. Don't argue.
Yeah. Yeah, and my God, don't put a bay window with little shutters on either side of it. Like, who thinks that looks good?
You know, we talked about what makes a
sorry if you do that, Andy. I don't
know do that.
Okay. Andy specializes. That's his other business.
Andy's taking notes over here. Oh my God! Thank God.
Shut it down for shutters.
Yeah.
You know, we talked about a comfortable floor plan. One of the things that we're striving to do right now, even on some of our bigger custom homes that are in the 5,000 square foot range, is getting rid of the dining room, and we have one space that reads as three with dining room open to the kitchen, open to the great room. And we might have a simple cased opening or a cedar beam or something that delineates those spaces, but they're still connected. And I mean, that almost every house we're doing right now is like that.
And that's what we're doing in a lot of our remodels. We're going in and removing walls and opening up that space to have that continuous flow.
Yeah. Remodeling these days is so much about changing door openings. I'm doing one on Sunday.
Well, you can change the feel of a place by just simply taking a 6-foot wall down and creating a whole new...
And honestly, it's not, for a remodeling point of view, it's not as crazy expensive as a lot of people might assume. Sometimes Sometimes it can be really hard.
There's a bearing wall.
Yeah.
I think it all depends on the builder you get.
But
some guys don't want to touch it and they go, it's $11,000.
Yeah.
And other guys will be like, it's a weekend.
Yeah.
Maybe it's $3,000.
Yeah.
But I think the last part of that whole thing about how do you make a house cozy is proportions again. Trim sizes, window sizes, casing, sills. You know, if you're doing wainscoting, how do you run it? Do you run it 5 feet? So it's at the horizontal point of the windows. You know, that's a huge factor.
I'm a huge fan of things lining up. Alignment, like if I don't have alignment in a room, I don't feel good.
You should see us walking around houses today. We're just stopping doorways.
Yeah,
don't want us coming through your house.
No, you
we were like, all right, I'm glad nobody's listening. You're like,
one thing that I learned from architect Mark Hutker, who I think, John, he practices in the Cape Cod on the islands.
He's doing one of ours now.
Is he? Sweet. Yeah, nice. So he talks about creating nooks and spaces within the fringe of a home. So you've got a big open floor plan that when you're there by yourself, it might be pretty uncomfortable to be in the midst of a big great room. So he'll create a little window seat or something off on the side that you can retreat to. And then when you have entertainment and the family's around, you could use that big kitchen. And so it just all comes out of scale and proportion. Just be mindful of it.
Yep.
Right. One of the biggest compliments that we get sometimes on our homes is that they almost feel furnished without furniture in them because of nooks like that and proper proportion of wainscoting and millwork.
That's awesome.
You don't walk into
the furniture.
You don't walk into a huge room and go, what would I do in here?
Yeah.
You'd be like, you can almost see like there's the two love chairs, whatever. Yeah. It all makes sense.
We're Very not cool. going there with the two love chairs.
What's a love chair, Johnny? A love seat?
Yeah, I don't do furniture, man.
Well, awesome. Thanks, you guys, for being able to swing by and talk to us for a little bit before we wrap things up from the show here. And glad everybody else could join us. Just a reminder, you can go to findhomebuilding.com/podcast, see the photos of all this stuff. Make sure to subscribe to the podcast, support us. We love it. Give us a little review. Make sure to check out Modern Craftsman Podcast with Johnny, Nick, and Tyler.
Thank you.
A big thanks to Jason and Andy for sitting in with us.
Jason, how can people follow you?
Instagram, Artisan Signature Homes, and hopefully I pop up first.
Yeah,
hopefully.
And again, for Andy at Modern Oak, Modern_Oak.
That's right.
Here's Johnny, obviously.
You got it, baby.
And Jeff, too. I mean, Jeff, you want to give a shout-out to your Instagram? Jeff Rose Video? Yeah. You can see... Yeah.
A lurker.
Until next time, we'll be getting back to our regular scheduled Friday shows. So stay tuned for that. And please let us know your thoughts and chime in on those comments and let us know what you think of the coverage from the show. And until next time, this is Justin for a big crowd of Rob, Andy, Johnny, and Jason saying, happy building and keep craft alive.